Meanwhile, in Germany, the swastika was about to become the official emblem of a new political party. In late 1918, the Munich Lodge of the German Order, the Thule Society, decided to create a workers' discussion group. Soon after, Anton Drexler, a locksmith and the group's most active member, proposed that they develop it into a political party. The Thule Society agreed, and on January the 19th, 1919, the new party had its first meeting in the Fürstenfelder Hof Tavern in Munich. It was named the German Workers' Party. Since the end of the Great War, the activities of right-wing political parties, the armed militias of the Free Corps, and the massive organizations of war veterans had been of the greatest interest to the German army. After the Treaty of Versailles, the victorious Western Allies had imposed strict limits on the German armed forces. The army couldn't exceed 100,000 men, and the weapons it could possess were strictly controlled. The army command, sympathetic to the aims of right-wing groups such as the German Order, armed and trained the Free Corps as a secret reserve, and were constantly on the lookout for promising political groups to support. To this end, it employed spies, trusted army veterans, some still serving soldiers, to report on the aims and loyalties of new parties. One such spy was the 30-year-old Corporal Adolf Hitler. On September the 12th, 1919, Hitler attended a meeting of the German Workers' Party. Within weeks, he had joined the party under army instructions. Soon, he was the most popular speaker at party meetings. And within weeks, had risen to become head of propaganda. On February the 20th, 1920, the party changed its name to the National Socialist German Workers' Party. The following May, it adopted as its symbol the emblem of its parent, the Thule Society. The symbol was the swastika. It was Hitler himself, as head of propaganda and an amateur artist, who designed the swastika flag adopted by the new Nazi party. The curved swastika of Thule was replaced by the straight-armed form. The swastika was black and placed inside a white circle on a red background. Black, white and red were the colors of the old German imperial flag. There's been much speculation that Hitler deliberately reversed the direction of the original Tibetan swastika in a sinister gesture, transforming it from a symbol of good luck into an emblem of evil. In fact, until now, the swastika as used by German occultists, right-wing political groups, and the Free Corps had no set direction. Both clockwise and anti-clockwise forms were commonplace. Why did Hitler choose the anti-clockwise tilted swastika for the Nazi party? Recently discovered records of a conversation between Hitler and a senior Nazi official have revealed the true reason. Hitler argued that since the swastika was the Aryan symbol of the sun, it must appear as the sun would have appeared to the ancient Aryans in their northern homeland of Thule. the sun would have seemed to roll across the horizon from east to west. The true swastika of the Aryans must therefore, Hitler argued, appear to roll anti-clockwise. Although the most common form of Nazi swastika was straight-armed, the curved swastika of Thule was not forgotten by the Nazi party to which it gave birth. It appeared on the belt buckles of the brown-shirted stormtroopers. Decorations for anti-partisan warfare on the Eastern Front displayed both the Thule swastika and dagger. The tanks of the SS Division Nordland also showed the Thule swastika. Whatever the form in which the swastika appeared in the banners and regalia of National Socialism, its meaning remained the same. It was the meaning claimed for it by Madame Blavatsky and Guido von Liszt. It was the symbol of the Aryan. In Hitler's words, the swastika was the sign of the mystical destiny of Aryan man. The Nazi fascination with swastika led to an extraordinary mission, a mission inspired by the SS and encouraged by Adolf Hitler. It was an attempt to trace the history of the Aryan race. A race that in reality existed only in the imagination of mystics. In 1935, an institution calling itself the Annenerbe was established by the Nazi government and soon came under the control of the SS. The Annenerbe, the ancestral heritage society for the study of Germanic prehistory, would grow to over 50 departments and control all archaeology in the Third Reich. Its official task was to show that the Aryans had spread from their ancestral lands in the north and had founded the great civilizations of history. All over the world, Annenerbe archaeologists searched for ancient swastikas to prove their claims. Wherever swastikas were found, they concluded that there had once flourished an Aryan civilization. The purpose of proving that all the greatest cultures had been founded by Aryans was to show that the Germans, the Aryans' supposed descendants, had a natural right to conquer at will and reclaim their ancient heritage. In 1937, in the city of Munich, National Socialism celebrated the supremacy of the Aryans and their imagined history as the origin of all cultural achievements. Everywhere there are swastikas, venerated as the symbol of the Aryan racial destiny. Under the Nazis, the myth of the Aryan propagated by the occultists of an earlier generation was transformed into a state religion. The sign of this new religion was the swastika, the National Socialist substitute for the Christian cross. While the majority of the German people are skeptical or even hostile to the party's attempts to replace Christianity, and Hitler is wary of direct conflict with the Christian churches, the Nazis believe that they have time on their side. All German youth must be members of one of the party organizations for young people. And it is in these that the new creed is most blatantly preached. In the rituals of the Hitler Youth, readings from the Bible are replaced by readings from Mein Kampf. A Hitler Youth hymn is taught, "No evil priest can prevent us from feeling that we are the children of Hitler. Away with incense and holy water. The swastika brings salvation on earth." In the League of German Maidens, the Nazi youth organization for girls, pageants are held in which the curved swastika, a legacy of the Thule Society, was carried in procession. And the supposed religious rites of ancient Germanic tribes reenacted. The official German calendar was also changed. All references to Christmas were banned and removed from school books. Instead, there was a winter festival dedicated to the sun. The summer solstice, too, became an official holy day, in which ceremonial fires were lit all over the Reich. In nocturnal rituals, Nazi gatherings chanted fire incantations. In the new Nordic religion of the Nazis, the fantasies of the Germanic mystic Guido von List had become a reality. So too had the Aryan Empire he preached. With Hitler's program of conquest and racial annihilation, the swastika flew triumphant over vast tracts of Europe and the Soviet Union. Less than 60 years after Madame Blavatsky had identified the swastika as the sign of the Aryans, it had completed its transformation. From the Buddhist symbol of good fortune, the swastika had become the most feared and hated symbol in the history of the human race.